Greetings, everyone, and thank you for joining us here at the Cathedral Church of St. Mark for the contemplative evening prayer. Let my prayer be set forth in your sight as incense, the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. Dear friends in Christ, here in the presence of Almighty God, let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
O gracious light, your brightness of the ever-living Father, Jesus Christ, holy and blessed, now as we come to the setting of the sun, and our eyes behold the vesper light, we sing your praises, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of the flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses. And we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your doing, it is a gift of God, not the results of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Gospel according to John. Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe in him are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come into the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So the practice of Lectio Divina is an ancient practice going back to the earliest days of the church. It just means sacred reading. And there's a very similar practice found in the Jewish tradition called Haggadah. Because we live post-Gutenberg in the age of the printing press and email and the internet, it's important to distinguish how we read now from how the practice of Lectio Divina was originally intended. Now we read for information, and most of us are very adept at scrolling through an article on our phones and getting the little factoids that we need. Practice of Lectio Divina, though, asks us to listen and read from a different place. You could actually say that the practice of Lectio Divina moves us from our head to our heart, or to a place where the mind is in the heart and they see as one integrated whole. We read not so much to glean information, but to be formed, for formation, that we might be a little bit more like the one we follow after down the way of love and call Lord, a little bit more like Christ. And because Scripture is living and active, it speaks to each one of us right here and right now with a word of comfort, a word of challenge. The practice is to descend with the mind into the heart and listen from that open, receptive, allowing place for a word or phrase that pops up as we read through the scripture. And the practice in this first movement of Lectio Divina is to turn that word or phrase over in your heart. You're not analyzing it, thinking about it, reflecting upon it, but just turning it over in your heart silently, chewing it like a cow chews its cud, as the desert fathers and mothers were fond of saying, getting a sense of its savor, its perfume, spending time being with. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. second moment or movement of Lectio Divina is called meditatio, or meditation or reflecting. So first we read, and now the invitation is to reflect, that is to use those God-given powers of memory, reason, imagination, under the pressure of grace, illumined by the Holy Spirit, to ponder in our hearts, like Jesus' mother, Mary, what it is this word, phrase, or sometimes image has to show us about ourselves, our relationship to others, our relationship to God's good creation, and even to God in God's self. My metaphor for this movement of Lectio is that it's akin to standing in a threshold or a doorway. And in fact, we actually are always standing in some kind of threshold or doorway, even if we don't recognize it as such. Before us lies the new way of seeing and being in the world, dependent, little, nourished by God's grace, where the pearl of great price is lying before us, and at our backs is the same old business as usual, that deeply patterned, mechanical way of navigating the world that we're very good at. And yet, we begin to have a sneaking suspicion that it seems not to work very well, that in fact it has revealed itself to bring only suffering for ourselves and others. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. Third movement of Lectio Divina is called oratio, or prayer. or responding. So we read, we reflect, and as is often the case in this manner of prayer, we find ourselves often spontaneously moved to respond. And it's a little capsule, actually, of the life of discipleship. God's love, God's word comes first. It impresses itself upon us. It breaks in to our ossified way of seeing and being, nourishes us. We get a glimpse of some new way. But then comes the moment where we're actually asked to respond, not just with our lips, but with our lives. And so this movement of lectio kind of patterns that habit of response in us. And we respond not by trying to sound like somebody else. We don't put on our church voice and try to sound like Thomas Cranmer. We sound like ourselves because God loves us just as we are. And so we offer up a prayer that somehow encapsulates or reflects or is refracted by our engagement with that word or phrase. Best to think of ourselves as seated at the kitchen table enjoying a nice hot cup of morning coffee with someone who is strangely, disturbingly, inordinately interested in what we have to say and whom we can sense is loves us unconditionally. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and has raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places with Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. The final moment or movement of Lectio Divina is called Contemplatio, contemplation, or simply resting in God, as Gregory the Great calls it. So first we read, reflect, respond, and now the invitation is to rest. We lay aside our prayers, either silent or aloud. We lay aside our reflections and our meditations, and we allow ourselves to simply be, to be present to the presence of God, who is always present to us in the inner room of the heart. Properly speaking, of course, contemplation arrives as sheer gift. It's not a work. It's not a technique that we can do well or badly. It's the fruit of a regular, nourished relationship with God in Christ through the Holy Spirit. Nonetheless, there's habits or dispositions, little practices that we can employ that dispose us to the reception of that gift. And so in this stage, we use that word or phrase as a kind of anchor for our attention and our longing and our love for God. And when we find ourselves pre-living our lives and thinking about the future, reliving our lives and mulling over the past, we return to the simple recitation of the word or phrase in faith with love as a way of coming home to the one who has made his home in us. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. Before we move to the recitation of the Apostles' Creed, I encourage you to take a few moments just to engage in some faith sharing. That is, sharing with one another what word or phrase popped out for you, how you were reflecting upon its meaning for you, the hold it has on you, perhaps what prayer you were offering up, and how you might resolve to live your life a little differently in the week to come. And even if you're at home by yourself, I encourage you to grab a pen and paper and just jot down some notes as to what reflections were moving through you in the time of the prayer, and to return to that as kind of a spiritual reset button every couple days. Often what you'll find is that the scriptures are revealed as immeasurably rich when you hear how other people were reflecting on the same passage, different words, different images, different phrases, and how they can be applied to individual Christian lives. It shows you that Scripture is actually a living document, very much like a multifaceted jewel that rotated just half a centimeter, reveals an entirely new vista and perspective. And sometimes when we hear that, see that, recognize it, it strengthens our faith that we can be open and attentive to the new things, even well-known and well-worn passages might show us. Standing as we are able, let us affirm the faith of the Church in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. That this evening may be holy, good, and peaceful,
we entreat you, O Lord.
That your holy angels may lead us in paths of peace and goodwill,
we entreat you, O Lord.
That we may be pardoned and forgiven for our sins and offenses,
we entreat you, O Lord.
That there may be peace to your church and to the whole world,
we entreat you, O Lord.
That we may depart this life in your faith and fear and not be condemned before the great judgment seat of Christ,
we entreat you, O Lord.
That we may be bound together in your Holy Spirit in the communion of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, St. Mark, our patron, and all your saints, and trusting one another and all our life to Christ,
we entreat you, O Lord.
Jesus, you are the way through the wilderness. Show us your truth in which we journey, and by the grace of the Holy Spirit, be in us the life that draws us to God.
Amen.
Keep watch, dear Lord, with those who work or watch or weep this night. And give your angels charge over those who sleep. Tend the sick, Lord Christ. Give rest to the weary. Bless the dying. Soothe the suffering. Pity the afflicted. Shield the joyous. And all for your love's sake.
Amen.
Gathering up our prayers and thanksgivings, let us say together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth and in the age to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Amen. Amen.